Hi, I'm the rap critic. Let's talk about country rap. Now, rap and country fusions have always been seen as a joke, a novelty to not be taken seriously. And to be fair, a lot of it is, to be quite frank, it's really bad. Yep, on my tractor. Oh my god, I really tried to find some good examples. And I'm not gonna say that rap and country is automatically a bad mix, but it would certainly seem that the only people that are trying it are the people that are bad at it. You either get something boring and generic like that Toby Keith Nelly song, or you get the awkward trying to be down with the hippity hop songs. Well, I don't give a dang about nothing. I'm singing and bling blingin'. Oh word, you're bling blingin'? Is that what you're doing? Do you have any idea what that word even means? Something about attempting to cross these genres seems to always bring out the worst in any artist. If you don't judge my gold chain, I'll forget the iron chain. The less said about LL Cool J, the better. However, a few years ago, a fan showed me Shadows by Yellow Wolf, a self-proclaimed redneck MC who I dare say made a pretty haunting crossover track with Joshua Headley. Now, that song didn't chart, but it definitely proved to me that it was possible to make a country rap song, especially with someone like Yellow Wolf who seemed to be knowledgeable of how to pull off both genres. Of course, today's song isn't anywhere near that level of emotional depth or labyrinthine imagery, but I'll be damned if I didn't say Old Town Road isn't fun as shit. Yeah, I'm gonna take my horse to the Old Town Road. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more. It manages to have this charm to it where you can tell it started as a joke, but the overall product is so proud to be the little crossover genre song that it is, it's kind of refreshing. Whereas with most country mashups, the song either feels like what makes both genres interesting is stripped away and watered down like with Over and Over, or the rapper just awkwardly shoves in farming references, but only in relation to typical rap topics. I got horses in my car like a farmer. See, he's not really talking about having a horse, he's talking about the horsepower in his car. But Lil Nas X, on the other hand, I got the horses in the back, horse stock is attached. This isn't a metaphor, he literally has a horse, and you can tell he's gonna ride it because he talks about putting that horse tack thing on his face. Is that what those things are called? Well, look at that, we're all learning something today. But yeah, a big part of its appeal for me is how it actively embraces its existence as a crossover track by openly mixing the tropes of each topic. Riding on a tractor, lean all in my blood. Cowboy hat from Gucci, Wrangler on my booty. It's like mixing the materialism of mainstream hip hop with the checklist of stock images that's seemingly mandatory in mainstream country. My life is a movie, but riding in boots. Still shocked by the usage of the word boobies by anyone over the age of 10. But forget it, maybe that's just my pet peeve. Speaking of pet peeves though, not everyone was enjoying the fact that this trap country song was so big it actually started climbing up the Billboard country charts. Namely, the people behind the Billboard country charts, who claim that the song's musical composition doesn't embrace enough elements of today's country music to chart in its current version. You know what though? Maybe they're right. Maybe it has nothing to do with race, as they claim, and it's instead about the fact that the song wasn't made the way country songs are typically made. The main country-sounding element in the song is the banjo, and since that's a sample, it indeed isn't the way most traditional country artists make music. Country songs are supposed to be made by a band with real instruments, right? And on a fundamental level, the song is made with a sample. Not playing your own instruments, actively trying to sound like another genre outside of country? And you know what? I'd be fine with them calling all of that out. If they did the same thing with white country artists. In fact, before we get to that, let's just say that sampling a country song doesn't automatically make a song country. But here's the rub, he's not sampling a country song. He's actually sampling a song from a genre called dark ambient. And for those of you who don't know what that typically sounds like, it usually sounds like this. But at one point, that exact same song sounds like this. For a brief second, you can see the potential for this dark ambient song to be a low-key country instrumental. And what the producer of the Lil Nas X song did was enhance the country-sounding element by making it the prominent sound of the track. But here's the thing. You thought it was sampling a country song, didn't you? You heard the beat originally and it came off like a country song sample. And you can't deny that because, like, people are literally using it for TikTok cowboy transformation memes. But okay, maybe they object to it on a more direct genre basis. I mean, come now, as much as the layperson may like this song, music heads can hear at a basic level the song isn't designed like a true country song. You know, like that Shania Twain Come On Over album, or the multiple times I've heard Shake It Off and We Are Never Getting Back Together on country stations. And I don't even really listen to country radio that much, but whenever I do, I have heard those songs. And you cannot tell me Shake It Off and We Are Never Getting Back Together is country. So I don't want to hear what really sounds like modern country music, because honestly, country music's been trying to schmooze in with pop and hip-hop for the last couple of years. No, for real, this song is apparently one of the biggest quote-unquote country songs of the past couple of years. If it's meant to be, it'll be, it'll be. baby, just let it be. You hear any of that down-home country organic instrumentals in this beat? No, it's a completely mechanical beat with virtually no instruments that distinctly sound like they're of country origin. But they got southern accents, so hey, there it is on the country airplay charts like it's nothing. So breaking genre convention is most certainly not an issue, especially if country radio thinks it'll attract a few more ears. And quiet is kept, I think Old Town Road sounds way more directly country than any of the songs I just told you about. And besides, sure, we're talking about musical composition, but shouldn't lyrical composition count too? And hey, he's hitting all those country song tropes, isn't he? I mean, sure, there's an obvious tongue-in-cheek, jokey reason why he's doing it, and as we all know, country music is always serious 100% of the time. But oh well, they made their decision, so I guess that's the end of the story. That is until Billy Ray Cyrus jumped on the scene. That's right, no joke, after hearing that he had been kicked off the charts for not sounding country enough, Mr. Achy Breaky Heart himself hopped on the remix. Got no stress, I've been through all that. I'm like a Marlboro man, so I kick on back. Didn't the Marlboro man die of lung cancer? Like, I know this is just here to evoke the fabricated grandiosity of 19th century cattle ranchers, but that one's kind of awkward now, because like, the thing that made him cool literally killed him. Not the metaphor I'd go with, is all I'm saying. But you know what? Even I could ignore that in the face of the carefree vibe this song has going for it. I mean, not the first country artist I'd go with, but you know, his family kind of owes hip-hop one anyway, so... Now, of course, many people are just saying this is a cheap way to cash in on this song's success. And, yeah, no, that's exactly what he's doing. He did it a few years ago, too, when he tried to cash in on his daughter's successful name with an Achy Breaky Heart remix. And it's really bad. You don't need to listen to it. Again, most country rap is bad. I'm sorry, it just is. But to be fair to the man, he actually did have to deal with his own pushback in the 90s, when the powers that be originally wouldn't let his big hit cross over to the pop charts. So there's a bit of solidarity in there in terms of both artists wanting to make songs that had appealed to different genres, but being stifled by arbitrary rules that hinder your success. And if you want to get into the meaning of the song, I mean, sure, it's still silly, but when you look at it, it's actually about having a good time in the face of solitude and rejection. In interviews, he says he wrote the song after dropping out of college and staying with his sister to avoid being found out by his parents. But after his sister didn't want to hold him up anymore, and with no future to look forward to, he wrote this song, with the first verse being about him packing up to leave. Which, knowing that, tinges the song with a bit of a different hue, and all that celebration through his understated delivery feels less like an aesthetic choice and more like a reflection of the actual loss he's going through, to the point where all the grandstanding about Gucci labels and nobody being able to tell him nothing comes off less as bratty defiance and more as just pushing away a world that didn't feel like it wanted you in the first place. And in the wake of that rejection, the only solace you have comes from just doing the thing you love until you physically can't do it anymore. And whereas with most people it's dancing, books, video games, whatever, for Lil Nas X, hey, it just happens to be the feeling of riding a speeding horse long into the night till you're too tired to think about the problems in your world. And maybe Billy Cyrus is just cashing in on a hot song, but he makes a point when defending it. What's the rudimentary element of a country western song? It's honest, humble, has an infectious hook, and a banjo. What the hell more do you need? And hey, the war isn't over. Apparently Billboard is still considering how to categorize the song, so maybe we'll see an update by the time this episode comes out. But as it is, I give the song and its remix a 3 out of 5. Its super short length makes it so it doesn't have enough time to wear out its welcome with the gimmick it's using, but at the same time, Billy Ray Cyrus's inclusion adds a dynamic that kinda makes me feel like the song's not done yet. I don't know, maybe the low-key nature of the track is what works for him, but part of the surprise of the song was how it actually sounded like a real banjo was playing on the track, and it would've been dope to get Billy to play a little guitar solo at the end, and maybe some more layered harmonies to expand the sound a bit. But hey, I'm not gonna tell the guy what to do. Like the man said, "Can't nobody tell me nothing." And I'm inclined to believe that statement. I mean, anyone willing to make a trap country song probably ignored the advice of a lot of people. But hey, this song should serve to remind us that we should always follow our dreams. Because if there's one dream that shouldn't have come true, it's the dream of a guy who remixed a dark ambient track by a 90s industrial metal group into a trap country song that became a top 40 smash hit. Never let anyone tell you what's impossible is the lesson for today, kids. Well, that's the episode. If you want to hear this and other songs I'm into, check out my digital radio show on Station Hit. I'm getting more into my schedule over there that I like to stick to when I'm not working on episodes, so join me over there. Hit up the Going Off Podcast on Spotify, because all our episodes, including the new ones, are over there now. And of course, please like, comment, subscribe, check out my Rap Critic merch on Teespring that I'm wearing. Support me on Ko-fi if you want to do one-time donations. Check out my Patreon if you want to make requests and peep what I'm doing behind the scenes. And until next time, I'm the Rap Critic. You don't have to like a genre, but don't hate on it when the shit's done well.